As a kid, Halloween was arguably one of the best holidays. You got to be silly, dress up with your friends, and each and every year you were looking for the biggest candy haul. But beyond all that was America's favorite pastime. Yes, I'm talking about Disney's Monstober. If you grew up in the late 90s and early 2000s, you probably remember Monstober. It was the time of the year where Disney would play all their banger Halloween movies, such as Halloween Town 1, Halloween Town 2, Halloween Town 3, Halloween Town 4, and of course Hocus Pocus. I put a spell on you. But beyond all those, as a kid, there was one movie that really stuck with me, one movie that was really ingrained in my mind ever since the first day I saw it. That movie is called Can of Worms. You may or may not remember Can of Worms, a lot of people don't, but if you do, welcome to the club. Now before I get into this movie and all its beauty, let me just tell you why. As a kid, I was always so excited to watch all the Disney Halloween movies, the Halloween Towns, the Hocus Pocus, the Tower of Terror, all of those movies. I loved watching them, but the one movie that I was always so excited to watch was Can of Worms. Now it wasn't until recently that I was sitting down with some friends talking about Halloween movies on Disney, and I brought up Can of Worms, and everyone looked at me like I was weird. Mind you, all these people are within my age group, so I found it really odd that they had never seen this movie. But sure enough, with the power of the World Wide Web, I found the movie, showed it to my friends, and proved my haters wrong. Now, I don't know if that means my friends are uncultured, I don't know if that means they didn't have cable, or maybe, I just have big brain. Can of Worms is a 1999 Disney classic starring Michael Shulman, Erica Christensen, Adam Wiley, Marcus Turner, and my favorite, Boehm. The movie starts out with our protagonist Michael, and he's this boy that believes he's from a different planet for some reason, so he builds this big-ass satellite dish to send a message/laser to space. Just the entirety of space, I guess. And that makes him super happy. Maybe a little too happy.
Yes!
Thor then strikes Michael with lightning, the movie's over, and the credits roll. I'm just playing. Now we flash back 2 weeks to before the lightning incident. So now we're at a scene where Michael's in a treehouse explaining this imaginary world to some friends that has like two moons and a purple sun, but then he goes on to explain how there's no war and no conflict, and it's like this perfect utopia, and honestly, I kinda like it. I would love to live there. Then after explaining how peaceful they are, he explains how the Johns attack, I guess.
Until the day the Johns attacked.
Them Johns be attacking. But then he kind of goes off the rails and talks about how the alien family was attacked and Alien Daddy actually got obliterated by the Johns. A pretty sad story for 3 minutes into the movie, and I think this kid agrees.
This is too sad.
Michael then explains that one of the alien babies from this imaginary universe that he has escaped and actually landed here on Earth. And, you know, pay no mind to that detail because it's definitely not the entire plot of the story. Okay, so Michael plays football because his dad peaked in high school and lives vicariously through him. Michael sucks at football. Obviously, it's not something that he wants to do. But now we meet the romantic counterpart, Caitlin. It's a pretty typical thing of the cheerleader who is way out of his league, but, you know, it's a Disney movie, so what else would you expect? Then there's this pretty awful scene that I actually kind of love where Michael gets just smacked during a football game and it actually just sends him straight to space.
Oh, he's down at the 10.
It's this pretty hilarious scene that's super cheesy where Michael gets knocked down and, you know, he's all dizzy and you think it's just going to be kind of like, oh, I got hurt. But then boom, he's in space talking to an alien astronaut who apparently wants his brains. It's ridiculous. Now, I haven't mentioned it yet, but you've probably picked up on it that Michael is a huge nerd and 50% of the jokes in the movie are him smart, you not. Haha, very funny.
Is a bio service routine?
Bio service routine is nothing more than an interrupt handler.
Are you sure?
Does a tesseract exist in four dimensions?
So the next scene, Michael tells his dad that he can't play football.
Did I say can't?
My bad. Michael says he doesn't want to play football anymore.
No, but I just don't think it's...
No buts about it.
Now we're back at the school, and the love interest comes into class, and obviously the jock likes her too, but she's not interested. But the jock has a trick up his sleeve. You know, the trick that every jock has. A hacker floppy disk. But apparently, Michael came prepared. They go back and forth having a little hack off.
Yes! Do it, Mike! Make him suffer!
Make him suffer.
Make him suffer.
It's a floppy disk. I like how Disney didn't go with the stereotypical, I'm big jock, I'm gonna beat your ass. They went more with the, I'm jock, I have big floppy disk. Oop, I'm nerd too. When I was rewatching this, I was just thinking, what if we took all the movies with, like, big supervillains and they just had big floppy disks, like Thanos, instead of snapping you, he just puts a floppy disk into your computer and wipes out the entire universe.
Do it, Mike. Make him suffer.
midsummer.
So we go back to the storytelling treehouse where Michael's sister comes in and says that Caitlin, the love interest, is in his room. I don't know how she got there, but it's followed by this hilarious running scene of Michael running inside that actually made me lose it every single time I watched it. The music is absolutely perfect, and it's just funny to think of, like, that music playing in any other running scene, like a chase scene in a movie, or, like, you're in a cop chase in real life, and you just have that song playing on the radio. So it turns out that Caitlin actually is in his room, which is super weird because we still don't know how she got there. I'm just assuming the sister let her inside and said, oh yeah, go ahead up into his room, without his permission. Yeah, go ahead, he'll love that. So Michael goes in his room and she's actually in there and she's already touching all his stuff, so Michael flexes that he's more powerful than NASA.
It takes digitalized data, right, through here, like anything from a computer, and it sends it out instantly, zap, right out into space to the farthest reaches of the universe beyond time and imagination.
She's super impressed with all his technology and asks him to help with the homecoming decorations for their school because they have a tight budget and she expects him to do everything for free and you can just make all these cool technology things for our dance, right? Then Michael says yes and she asks if that means yes and then he responds with yes.
Yeah, well, why not? Definitely, absolutely.
So that means yes?
Yes.
So there's a cool little montage of him doing all this nerdy stuff for the school dance, and she's loving that, and he's loving her, and they're obviously falling in love, yada yada yada, then she calls him an idiot, and he loves it.
You sure are an idiot.
The jock sees this and gets mad, so he breaks into the school with his henchmen, and they touch a computer. So now it's the night of the dance, and apparently Michael's a magician now. And the jock and the henchmen are watching from the sidelines, and the henchmen cannot wait any longer.
Push the button.
So the jock pushes a button and it instantly makes him become an arsonist. So here's where the movie gets crazy. The whole gym catches on fire and now we're back to where we started. Michael's super mad and he's gonna send a message to space. Michael's sad and he goes to school and surprise, surprise, Caitlin hates his guts because he blew up the entire school. We're now back at the treehouse and boom!
Dog with mouth necklace.
Dog with mouth necklace is actually from space, and his name is Barnabas, and he tells Michael that he accidentally opened a Stargate.
The Stargate!
So get this, Barnabas isn't actually a dog, he's an alien from space who is the leader of a space non-profit organization. Yes, that's actually what's said in the movie.
Disaster relief, rights violations, non-profit, of course.
Barnabas tells Michael that they have to get off the planet because other things are going to be coming through the Stargate, and Michael just thinks he's tripping. So Michael just says, oh word, I just saw a dog with a mouth necklace. Yeah, I must be super hungry. So he goes inside and he grabs some corn and a hamburger.
Or maybe I'm just hungry.
And oh baby, here we go. We get to meet my favorite character from the movie. Bone. Now this is something that I always looked past. Bone, this slime ball Jar Jar Binks looking dude. He is an interdimensional lawyer here to defend Michael's case. Yeah, apparently he is now being summoned to space court. Caitlin calls Michael while Bohm is just sitting on the desk eating Michael's food, and this causes Michael just to be a total asshole.
I wanted to say that I miss you.
No, that's nauseating.
This causes Caitlin to get mad and hang up the phone, and Michael gets mad at Bohm and says, hey, get out of here, and Bohm gets mad and says, okay, yeah, now I'm gonna sue you.
Wait till you hear from my lawyer. I'm suing you.
So not only does Michael now have to beat a space case, but he also has to beat a space lawsuit. I guess he's just gonna have to do the space race. And now, Barnabas is back, and we get the title of the movie said out loud.
Mike Pillsbury, you have opened up a can of worms.
So Michael has decided that he wants to go to space, but he wants to say bye to wifey beforehand, so he does some parkour and goes to Caitlin's house. Now Michael is on Caitlin's porch, and we get to meet the new homie, who is a space media agent who tases Michael, holds him captive, and just dips.
You know, I just love a captive audience.
Michael thinks he's adopted, he goes back to the treehouse with his hater friends that he usually tells the stories to, and now we get to meet the rest of the space business brigade. All of them want him for galactic marketing, except for this, like, pink fish thing that tries to seduce him.
Lots of fun.
Damn, that space fish about to make me act up. So So Mike pulled the trigger on going to space, and oh my goodness, in the scene, Caitlin is straight out of a horror movie.
At least in another world, I can make
So Caitlin comes inside, and Michael explains how she made him feel like no one else ever has. But honestly, man, like, that pink fish.
It'll be fun, Mikey. My parents would just die.
She might make you feel some type of way. So then there's this scene of all the aliens arguing in the treehouse about who's gonna get Michael. And like, amongst all the chitter chatter is one of the aliens just roasting the other alien's shoes.
Oh, you wear ugly shoes.
Oh, yeah.
It's 1999, and that alien had already said,
"What are those?"
All the aliens freak out for some reason, and we realize that the mean aliens have pulled up and they kidnapped the little kid. And Barnabas explains that if they don't go in and stop this, that the mean aliens are gonna keep pulling up and just stealing people until they have the perfect specimen. I'm not really sure where all this action came from, but hey, I'm here for it. So all of them come up with a plan, and they decide that they're gonna kidnap the jock, and they do it in the most horror movie jigsaw fashion possible.
Oh, old friender, it's me, Nick.
Like, did you really have to do it with a pig mask? And you just ended up taking it off like 2 minutes after waking him up? Like, imagine if every murderer in every horror movie did this exact same thing.
Hey, wake up, I'm gonna murder you. Hey.
Huh? Nah, I'm just playing, man, it's me.
Oh, what's up, dude?
I'm still gonna kill you.
Bet.
Basically, they tell the jock that he's gonna be bait for these galactic poachers that might kill him, and the only convincing he needs is Michael saying, "I dare you," and that's it. Now he's willing to die for this cause that he knows nothing about. So the space manies French kiss the jock on the chest, and the rest of them follow him into the portal. And boom, now we're on another planet. This planet is basically just a galactic zoo where species can come look at other species that are being held captive in cages against their will, and it's actually pretty messed up. It's almost just like SeaWorld and other zoos that we have in real life. They find some salt lamps at the zoo, and they see some species that look exactly like the ones Michael was explaining at the beginning of the movie. So Mike kind of just says, "Yeah, I called it," and then they leave. They meet the evil alien that's in charge of the zoo, who turns out just to be a dude with a weird Iron Man chest piece and absolutely zero drip, but then he becomes a lizard later, so it's okay. They play a big game of hide and seek with the lizard man, and then they rob him, and then Michael does some weird Mr. Miyagi magic on his dad or whatever he is, and then they save the jock and the little kid.
You guys okay?
Lizard man escapes, but no need to worry, because Michael vibes with the salt lamps and frees every other species in the zoo. Barnabas snitches on the lizard man and calls the space police, and then the space police come and arrest the lizard man.
All right, boat, hold it right there. Come where I can see it.
Now pretty much all the space stuff is over, and we cut to Michael playing football, and surprise, surprise, he's still trash. Then Barnabas says, "Hey, you beat the case," and the movie's over.
That was delightful.
And that's the 1999 Disney original Can of Worms. Maybe there's a reason no one remembers this movie, but for me, I still love it, and I love all of its creativity. I mean, the idea of a kid who doesn't believe he's from Earth, so a bunch of space businessmen wearing, like, real business dress shoes come down to Earth and try to get him to sign a deal, and he's like, "Nah, I want to be an independent artist," is so funny to me. And not to mention that Michael stays loyal to his girl Caitlin, even though that pink space fish was trying to seduce him. But yeah, I love this movie. Sure, it hasn't aged well, but for 1999, I think it's pretty awesome. Actually, this movie was such a huge part of my childhood that I vividly remember in second grade, we had this project around Halloween where we had to write a scary story or like a Halloween-themed story. Well, me being the person I was, I did not want to write a story. I didn't want to do homework. I just wanted to play with my toys. So I actually just ended up writing down the entire plot to Can of Worms, and I actually never got caught for it, so it's a big shout out to this movie for helping me pass my second grade Halloween project. If you don't think my explanation was good enough, you should go check the movie out for yourself. It's actually streaming on Disney Plus right now, I recently found out, and I think it might be on Amazon. I actually bought the movie to make this video because I don't have either of those platforms, but hey, you know, it's all in good fun. Thank you guys for watching this video. I know it's something different than what I've done before, and I don't know if you guys are gonna love it or hate it. I just wanted to do something different, and I enjoy making stuff like this, and I plan on making more, so if you don't like it, too bad. But yeah, that's it. Thank you guys. Like and subscribe, and leave a comment. Let me know if there's any other forgotten movies that I should talk about.
Goodbye, Barnabas. I'll never forget you.